Hey everybody, Matt Cover here again from howtobecomearacecardriver.com, and today on this video we're going to talk about the types of engine drag. Yes, we're getting into a little bit of technology here, but that's okay. I think all these things add up to make incredible drivers. The more knowledge you have, the better it's going to be. So let's just hop right on in and talk about the types of engine drag. Let's start with one that's really basic. By the way, these are all types of parasitic drag. Just means that while things are happening, they're stealing power, available power that could be used to propel the car forward, okay? So what we want to do is alleviate parasitic drag, and these are all examples of that, okay? So let's take a look at the first one, and I'm going to call it mechanical. That might be the official name. It might not be. That's okay. Mechanical drag. This happens from parts. Oh, no, I'm going to change that. This happens from metal to metal contact. And you have a lot of this inside the engine. Well, we're talking about piston rings on cylinder walls. We're talking about lifters that drag across cam lobes. All that kind of stuff. All those little metal on metal resistance. It's also, and I've also heard it called skin drag or surface drag. All those things that touch each other are really just types of parasitic drag, and they're robbing available engine power, okay? Not a whole lot you can do about these. You can get roller cams. You can get those little tiny piston rings. You can reduce the surface areas that touch each other. But really, you're kind of stuck with it. There has to be some mechanical components moving around. There has to be engine bearings, which touch on journals, which touch on whatever. So metal-on-metal contact, not a whole lot you can do about that one. So that one is there, and we're pretty much stuck with it to some degree. All right, we'll move on to the next one. This one's really interesting, and I'm going to call it inertia drag. And we've talked about polar moments of inertia before, and so you know that reducing something's weight can allow it to turn faster or change directions. A polar moment is simply an object's tendency to rotate around itself, okay? In this case, we're talking about moving components that are always trying to change directions. We've got pistons that go up and down. We've got push rods that go up and down. Connecting rods that go up and down. So there's all kinds of things that are changing directions all the time. Rockers that kind of pivot back and forth. All that kind of stuff, okay? And on the same note here, we can talk about rotational inertia. If you have a really heavy crankshaft and you're trying to accelerate it, you push the throttle, it has to kind of get out of its own way. If it's really heavy, it takes more power to get it to turn quicker than it does a lighter crankshaft, okay? And that's why it's really not that difficult to get 400 or 500 horsepower out of an engine that has very lightweight components, because they have very low polar moments of inertia, and the parts change directions very quickly. And that's really important. If you have a heavy components in an engine, it just robs a ton of power, because the engine's power is just going to changing the direction of all these parts. So lighter components are often very expensive, but they always pay off with power. So you can fight this inertia drag if you've got the money. So let's go ahead and talk about one last one real quick. And it is viscous drag. And as you know, an engine has to push all kinds of fluids around to operate properly. We're talking about, in some cases, power steering fluid. Not necessary, though. We're talking about engine coolant, which it definitely needs, and engine oil, which it definitely needs. Okay, so we're talking about the movement of fluid. There are things you can do to negate this. You've probably heard of dry sump oil systems. This is a really cool way to make power. Imagine for a second that your car is driving through a puddle, okay, and all that fluid is just kind of jumping up and splashing on you, and you can kind of feel the resistance when you drive into a big puddle. Well, that's what the crankshaft has to do inside the crankcase. There's tons of oil in there. It's rotating so fast, it's probably just a big oil cloud. And all that kind of splashy oil inside that crankcase is actually keeping the crank from moving as fast as it can. Okay, and a dry sump actually takes the oil away from the crankcase and pumps it through an external pump somewhere else. So everything gets lubricated properly, but you don't have to fight that oil. And by the way, that crank resistance inside there is called windage. And that's something else you can do to kind of resist viscous drag inside your motor. You see that on a lot of race cars. It's pretty expensive to put in a dry sump, but that is totally worth it. So in my opinion, lighter components and the dry sump will probably yield the best horsepower gains if you've got the money, because that stuff's all really expensive. So anyway, three types of drag. They're all parasitic, mechanical, inertia, and viscous. Do everything you can to fight them within your budget, because you will have a lot more power, and power is fun. Go ahead and click this box whenever you're done with this video. It'll take you right to the YouTube channel. You can subscribe through there. You'll never miss another video like this ever again. And I'll be back soon with another one from HowToBecomeARaceCarDriver.com.